So I'm going to share with you whatever large level ideas I have about implementing the kernel threads project. Now, everyone among you is already aware that you have to read this system call called clone, and to which you basically give a function pointer. The actual this will be the virtual address of the function where the thread starts running, and this stack, obviously this stack has to be created in the code of the process before you pass it to clone, and some flags and all, right? So let's begin with the struct proc. Now, because there are no threads, all you have is a struct proc. The first question remains is whether you want to have a separate structure for thread, or you want to basically have one structure for both process and thread. Now, most of you, and I don't know whether most or all of you, have actually decided to have one structure representing both the process and a thread. Now, you might have some reasons for that, but I think one primary reason for that remains is that you don't have to change this code. I think that is the prime reason, that you don't have to change the scheduler, because this code will simply pick up a next proc out of the table of procs, and then you don't have to change the scheduler. Now, I think that was not a big deal actually, if you had both process and threads. I thought it's not a big deal to rewrite this code. So maybe simply what you could do is in this struct proc, you have a thread pointer children, right, in the struct proc, which you anyway need to have to do even if you have the same structure. And you can have a struct thread and only include the fields which are per thread, right? So now, for example, the thread will have a pointer to its own stack, and the thread will obviously have a context, correct? It will have its own context. The open files will be shared with the parent process, so it will obviously have a proc pointer parent, so that you from a thread you can always locate its parent process. So that was one way of doing it, and this would perhaps mean that here what you do is you also have a loop here for p arrow children p arrow and okay, something like 2 equal to p arrow children and 2. Q is not null and Q plus plus. And here you simply check if the QR state is not enabled. So you basically end up scheduling a thread rather than scheduling a process. So some small changes would have required here, but I think most of you have not chosen this path. So I will not take this path. All right, I'll simply stick to the path where you have the same structure for both the thread and the process. Now, if you have the same structure, then still you are going to need this. And because now this very structure can represent a thread, you may need a parent to basically, create a hierarchy relationship between the threads which were created and the main thread. You may need this. Now, the real question that remains to be answered is what will clone do, and which are the things which will get shared, and which are the things which will not get shared. So the size will not change. The trouble is with the page directory. All right. So kernel stack, now obviously everyone by default will get a kernel stack. The trouble remains with the page directory, okay, when you create the process or and the thread. So let us go to fork first. This was supposed to create a process. Now you will, let us say you made a copy of the fork and you are trying to call it clone. And in this case, you don't have to even do it like Linux does, like specifying flags, what is to be duplicated, what is not to be duplicated. You can ignore all that. You can simply have one type of threads, that is sufficient. Now, this alloc proc does allocation of a process, but it also does few more things. So it actually initializes these things. So now this PID will become thread ID. The kernel stack will be allocated, which you definitely want to be allocated. The trap frame will be set up, which you want separately for every thread. Now, the thing which you want different is returning in either fork rate or clone rate. So you will have to get a clone return and a fork return. And you also think about whether the clone return needs to do something different from fork return. You need to think about that. So some pieces of this may need change. I'm trying to point out to the problem, all right, of the real problem, which is, I think, a difficult problem to solve. So the fork will do a copy of the process state from proc. So copy UVM is basically going to copy the entire process's page table. We don't have a fork which is a efficient fork, which does a copy and write. It is copying the entire page table. Now in clone, still make this call, or you simply want to say new process page dir is equal to curl proc page dir in clone. If you do this, then what happens is the code gets shared, no new frames are allocated, the data gets shared, no new frames are allocated, the heap gets shared, no new frames are allocated, kernel memory also becomes accessible, everything becomes accessible, but what about the stack? Remember, this page directory is also having mappings for the stack, both the kernel stack and the process stack. And you need to change that, this page directory. Even if you do this, you'll have to have a different mapping, at least for, you know, that particular page. Now, how is that doable? Because this page directory, that is the first page frame, that was the top level page directory, is same. It is same for the main thread and the parent thread. If you do the code like this, how do you plan to change only one page table entry? Because the stack is one page, so it will basically have one entry in the entire page table. So if the page table completely shared, how do you just make one entry different? That is not possible, actually. So that is why you cannot do this. You have to do this. You have to stick with this. That is my claim. Unless you find a better way of doing it. You have to do this. You have to copy the entire virtual memory. See, the pages won't change. The actual page frames are not going to change. What you really need to do while doing this is you don't use copy UVM, because what copy UVM also does is, you will see is it does this calloc and memory move. This you must not do. This you must not do, because then for every thread you are copying all the pages. That is a waste of it, and that again, if you copy them, then the globals are not shared. So what you really need to do is you simply need to change one entry in the page table. So the page directory and the page tables will get copied, but the actual pages will not get copied. So you have to rewrite this whole piece of code. You have to use a different function other than copy UVM. And within that, you have to rewrite this piece of code to only assure that the page directory is copied, the page table is copied, the pages are not copied, only one page of the stacks, both the stack is copied, and only those entries related to the stack are changed. That is what you need to do in your clone. All right. Now, other things are, I think, easier because they are all shared to open files and the thread ID. I think those are easy things to do. Even the current working directory, you can simply make a pointer and be happy with it. But it is the virtual memory mapping which is where the real challenge lies. So that was about the code of clone, okay, where you have some interesting challenges to face. Now the other challenge lies in the code of wait, because this wait is actually written, and we have not discussed the code of wait actually in the class, but I hope you have started reading it. This wait is designed for a process. You need to modify this wait for a thread, you know, so that you can join that particular code. I don't see any significant challenges in writing this code. you know, rewriting this weight so that it is a weight for a thread. If you have a single structure for representing both the thread and the process, I think there is nothing very challenging here. So I am done. All right. I think I have given you a broad idea of how to make changes to the kernel. I am open for questions now. So let me also tell you, so what exec does here is exec will do this unlock UVM and load UVM, but exec will also do this. Exec will also do this. It will set up the user stack so that the program being exec will start in the main function. Now you need to borrow from this to assure that a thread that has been created actually starts running in the function which is being called, also passing on the arguments to the function. So you need to actually borrow this code. And how will you do that? Because you have a single structure. We are going to have a single structure. You are going to have a clone, which is a copy of the fork, right? And when the fork returns, remember, the fork returns in fork red. So you will have something similar to this called clone red. So it is in clone red that you can actually do the job of setting up the user stack of the process where the arguments are passed. I hope you got my point. You'll have to write a function like clone red, which will get called from after the clone has returned, and in the clone thread you can do the setting up of the parameters on the stack. Does it make sense? Please give me some feedback.
Yes, sir.
Oh, so ask me questions, whatever things are not yet answered. I think the memory mapping part is something which most of you are missing so far. That is what I figured out from the discussions in the regular lab sessions. So I wanted to cover that.
Hello, sir.
The
fork ret actually returns to trap ret.
First it returns to fork ret and then it returns to trap ret.
I mean, so fork ret actually doesn't do enough significant work except for the first process.
First process, correct.
First process. So for clone ret, it will be like just a return. Because if the setting up of the stack is done in clone, that's fine, right?
That's fine. You can do it anywhere. But then it has to return, na?
Yeah, it has to return. Right.
It has to return. So if you say it returns in fork ret, I'm fine, but it should work.
Yeah, okay, so much.
No questions from anyone?
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, in the GitHub link you provided in the project description, the join takes argument as void pointer stack. So why should it take a void pointer stack? Instead, it should take nothing, no argument, right? Or just the thread ID.
What are you referring to? Can you say it again? The description that I have provided on Moodle?
Yeah, the GitHub link on the description you provided on the Moodle.
Oh, the Ramsey wala link.
Yes.
Let me check. I think he has described the same thing that I described. Okay, I can't find what you're referring to. Oh, okay, the int join. Why is it a double pointer? Is that what you're asking?
Yes, sir.
Your question is why is it not a single pointer? Why is it a double pointer?
Yeah, like why the stack is needed in join system call?
I'm thinking. I think you can do it without that also. He has a particular idea in his mind. So this Ramsey fellow who has written this page, I think he did it in a particular way because you have to return the PID of the waited for child, right? So that it is borrowing from the stack of the child. I think it's a very weird way of doing it. You simply have a extra variable in the struct proc to remember the return values of all the children. And whenever child is over, that value will get noted in the proc. And you can always return that value from the proc. There is no need to do it like this.
Okay, sir. Like I was thinking only thread ID is sufficient.
Yes, so I think he is doing this all this weird thing only for the thread ID, which you could always maintain in the struct proc. You could always maintain the thread IDs of, you know, expired threads in the proc.
Yes.
Any more questions? Okay, so then we will stop and we will gather again when you people think there are sufficient points to discuss in a separate session. All right, so we'll stop now. Thank you.